well, welcome to our very last wine and lecture of 2016. Gosh, it's been a really celebratory year, week, hasn't it? We had the parade, and who was at the Senior Center opening yesterday? We know what yours is. Wonderful, wonderful facility, and it's just awesome that we saved the best for last this year with New York Times. I do want to acknowledge our board members in the room, our president, Jane Braun. I know some of you call her Jane Brown. Either one works, Kit Williams. Sarah Wells there in the back. So we really appreciate what they do. We have members of our membership committee here tonight. They were pouring the wine and helping serve us tonight. And they're here to say to you, if you're not members, why not? We want you to be involved in what we do. Actually, the membership discounts pay for the membership. So come, please be a member of CHA. We have a lot of exciting things going on. I have a couple of exciting announcements for you. This is our row of honorary chairs here for our gala, which is going to happen on March the 18th. It's going to be at the Marriott. And do you want me to tell them the theme? Or is it a secret?
No, that's
okay. It's cottages to castles and the stories people tell. So it's going to be very intriguing. So please mark your calendars for that. And our first wine lecture in 2017 is going to be on January the 6th. We're actually going to be previewing a show that KPBS is going to be airing. They followed six incredible seniors for months at a time. And they're going to highlight their life and how they live their life. And it's a wonderful way to start your new year after all the holiday goodies to watch these videos. And we're going to have a panel of people here. The executive director is going to be here. We're going to preview the show. And a local Coronado gentleman is going to be the senior they feature first. And that's our own Richard Williams. So I think we put the ticket being online today. We're selling out every wine lecture. So we hate turning people away, but we have been turning away people. So get your tickets early if you're interested. I'm going to turn over the mic now to the very distinguished, the longtime board member of CHA and now advisory member Phil Monroe.
Thank you, Janet. Thank you. It's really a pleasure for me to introduce Casey Tanaka, our mayor.
Yeah.
At least five times and perhaps 10 times since Casey beat me. In the 2008 election for mayor, I've told him to his face, I'm glad you won. Casey has been a great mayor of Coronado. During the 2008 election, Casey had a key line he used at every forum. You know he's a history teacher, and he would tell people, you trust me with your children, now I'm asking you to trust me with your village. Yeah. Try as I might, I couldn't come up with a counter to that appealing request, but in reality, we both won. I've had eight great years since 2008, and I know Casey has had eight fabulous years leading our city. Casey's lived up to the trust we placed in him many times over. One of Casey's strengths is how he conducts council meetings. To illustrate, I'll share a personal revelation I had, and there's a couple admirals in the room that will relate to this, I'm sure. But I discovered that serving on city council takes a different kind of leadership than I had in 30 years in the Navy. When I was commanding officer in the Navy, we'd have a meeting, and I might say something like, I wonder what would happen if we tried this. And they would leave the meeting. 2 weeks later, they'd come back and, hey, boss, you told us you wanted us to do this. And this is what happened. And that's not quite what it was. Well, on council, I would have a great idea. I would put it out to the people. And they would look at me and say, do you have two more votes? years ago, you've seen that strength of Casey. When there were issues that had divided the council, Casey would often tell the other council members, I see two votes for that. If there isn't a third, I think we should move on. He made them aware that it takes three votes. His leadership of council meetings has been superb. I hate to see his time as mayor end. Coronado has been in good hands. Mayor Casey Tanaka.
Well, one of the things to love about Phil is his modesty. He gave me quite a beating in 2000. He came in second. Only Patty Schmidt had more votes, and I came in fourth. So that was an interesting election, because Kerry Downey and I were both in it, and we both lost. And something else I've noticed is that there are two times where Kerry and I both lost. We both lost in 2000. We both lost in 2016. So, you know, it's not always wins, but we're all stronger for it. So when I was asked, you know, would you like to talk about your years as mayor, I was delighted to do it, but I was trying to think of, well, what should the theme be? And I thought I would focus on what matters most to me, the relationships I've had with the people I've served with. If you ask me to name, well, what did we do in 2013 or 2008, I don't know that I could tell you much, and if I could, it'd be one thing. But I know what will always stand out to me are the people that I worked with, how we interacted, and one of the great things about democracy and city councils, every one of us brings a different strength. There wasn't another history teacher on the council. You know, usually there was only one attorney. We'd have, you know, one or two people with naval experience or business experience. We'd have some in their 30s or 40s or 60s. And so I always have thought that that's one of the great strengths of Coronado's government has been its diversity. And I also want to thank all of you for a thousand things, but I want to thank all of you for defying all the stereotypes that Coronado has. You know, the people over the bridge can't wait to try to live up some stereotype they think of us in Coronado, and time after time, they're just wrong about us. And that you elected a fat, young, Asian guy, I think, who's a Democrat, I think defies all those stereotypes. But, so I want to walk you through some of the people I've had the great fortune to work with, share a couple of thoughts about each of those council members, bring you to the present, and then at any presentation I give, usually the most meaningful part is the question and answer afterwards. And I can't express how honored I am to see all of you here tonight. It means a great deal to me, and it's a wonderful and humbling way to leave office. So thank you, and we'll get started. So, this is the first city council I was on. Yeah. And something that was really important in my growth as a leader or a human being was that I had a chance to join a city council with a great deal of experience and a great deal of wisdom, and I was certainly the least wise of that group. And the only wise thing I could do when I joined the city council in 2002 was to shut up. And I wasn't always good at that, but I understood, you know, I need to sit back and take things in. And I couldn't have had three better mentors than Phil Monroe, who's sitting here today, and certainly Tom Smyzik and Patty Schmidt. So I'm gonna talk about those first mentors I had and try to share some of the things that I admire about them, or hopefully that I've incorporated into things that I do. I don't know if people know it, but a lot of times when I receive a compliment about something I do, I feel that the person they're really complimenting is Tom Smyzik. Because I don't really believe you can be a good mayor if you haven't been a council member first, or at least someone that really is intimately familiar with the decisions of past city councils, what's been going on. You can't take your place until you've observed what others have done. And I don't think there's anyone on the city council that I've probably paid more attention to than Tom Smyzik. And Phil paid me one of the ultimate compliments. He said I run a good meeting. And I have to say, if anyone thinks I run a good meeting, then that really means Tom Smyzik runs a good meeting, because most of the things that I do are things I've observed about him. Most of the phrasing, the way things go. And that's one small example. When I say you can see Tom's fingerprints all over the place, one of the things that Phil and I know are proudest of about the city council is how we ran the finances of the city. You know, we tried to run it the way a smart family runs things. We didn't spend more money than we took in. We always tried to make sure that we saved a certain amount of money. And frankly, you know, maybe we bragged a little too much about how much money was in the general fund reserve. Whenever there was a re-election campaign, that's usually one of the first things we pointed out, is that we told you that, you could trust us, and the proof of it was that money was saved away for a rainy day. Some other things about Tom that I've observed that are worth noting: we have brand new facilities everywhere. And one of the brand new facilities that Tom was really, I think, the visionary behind is he felt that this community didn't have a great room where everyone could gather for big events. I know a lot of you have had weddings, a lot of you have had, you know, big events of your own, and whenever you deal with a hotel, God bless them, they're going to mark it up as much as they can. They're going to try to run the food and beverage bill up as much as they can. They're going to charge you a room fee, a security fee, I thought about you fee. And I don't blame them. It's a capitalist society we live in. Their bottom line needs to go up. But you know, you want your bottom line to be in a good place. And I think Tom recognized that. And one of the central features in terms of public facilities is our community room, the Nautilus Room. It's a huge place. Yeah. My sister got married there, and I'm sure all of you have your own memories and your own stories. And Thomas Fizek deserves a lot of credit for how well, not just that building came out, but how well the community center, the great room, the linear park that's next to it. We have a brand new city hall that we moved into in 2005. And Tom doesn't deserve the credit for starting a redevelopment agency, but Tom and Phil and Patty deserve the credit for making sure that the finances were there before we moved on, and you know, we were able to build all these things and still squirrel money away. So again, I truly believe Tom's fingerprints are all over this community in a great way. Now, I hear Kelly Purvis is here, and I think she's the one that found this picture, and she's the reason I could find it on Google, so thank you, Kelly. I would have to say that if I had to say the person who mentored me the most in the first year or two, and this is no offense against Phil, I sat next to Patty. And I was lucky to. You know, I don't get to choose, you just kind of get slotted in, and I got a great seat, because on one side of me was Patty Schmidt, and on the other side of me was the city manager. So I was in a great position to whisper. And I can tell you one little story that you may have heard. When I first joined the city council, the city manager pulled me aside and he said, "Casey, you have a couple of special duties." Okay, and I'm thinking I'm a rookie. Why would you give me any special duties? But I'm sitting next to Patty. One of my special duties was, "You need to always make sure Patty's microphone is on." And she doesn't always pay attention to that. So you need to be Johnny on the spot about that. I don't know if you ever observed the city council meeting between 2002 and 2004, but I was very intently focused. Her microphone was never off. I took that duty really seriously. But anyone who's ever sat next to Patty Schmidt on the city council has the good fortune of knowing what she really thinks about something. There were many times where Patty would lean over to me and be like, and as I said, I observe people's strengths, I observe the things they do well. If there's something I think they're not doing well, I try not to replicate it. I don't have a purse. But if I did, one of the things that I would replicate from Patty Schmidt was when you spoke at a council meeting and she did not like you, that was time to clean your purse. Now, I have a huge wallet. I've never had a council meeting cleaned it out because I was so irritated, but I have watched Patty do that a few times. There were times where we'd have a council meeting and something was being projected, and you could also, again, tell she was losing interest. Because sometimes you move your chair so you can see things better. Patty would move her chair like against the wall. She had a lot of little tricks, and if you recall, whenever she ran for council, her slogan was, "You know where she stands." And it was true. You know, it was a real pleasure and honor to get to serve with Patty. The tagline I gave for her is that she was a Coronado fiscal conservative before it was cool to be one. Now, I don't know how much you pay attention to city council campaigns, but I have not met the city council candidate that doesn't try to tell you how conservative they are with city finances, myself included. And if you're really sharp, you can say, "Well, Casey, why were you so big on spending money on this or on this?" And I'd have to say, "Sometimes you have to make important decisions. It's worth the money, you know, I mean, that is how it is." But one of the things that made Patty stand out was she was willing to say no when it was tough to do so. And I remember there were certain council meetings where she would say to me afterwards, "Well, you voted wrong again, but I still love you." Or... And I have to say, I don't know if I would be mayor today if it weren't for Patty, because she was one of the people that supported me very early on. When I first ran for city council when Phil won and I lost, Patty Schmidt and Phil won. And I remember there was a question on nuclear power at one of our debates. And someone asked, because if you recall, there was a little bit of a controversy about whether or not we needed radiation monitoring. And so, you know, there was a group of people on First Street that felt like we don't need to assume the Navy's always going to be honest. We should have our own monitors. And so, you know, that was one of the issues. So when I was asked about this later in 2002, how do you feel? I felt pretty fortunate, because in college at UCSD, I did my thesis on Admiral Rickover. So I know a lot about nuclear power. I know that they have, you know, usually two reactors on the average carrier. On Admiral Spain's carrier, they had eight, I believe. So, you know. So when they asked me, you know, where do you stand on nuclear power, which is kind of a silly thing to ask a Coronado City Council debate, but they asked, I was, you know, happy about that. And I said, well, I believe in it. You know, that's a ship that doesn't need to burn diesel oil all over the world. That's a ship that's not putting soot into the air. You know, and so I was able to answer. I remember Patty paid me the ultimate comment that night, and she won and I lost. When it was her turn to answer, her answer was, ditto. I tell people that I went to, I think, Patty's first debate in maybe 1988 when I was in middle school. I can assure you there were no other middle schoolers at that forum that day. And I remember seeing her, and I tell you, she looked like she was about to go to choir. She looked very austere. It was a black skirt, a white shirt, and just a frown the whole way. Yes. But she intrigued me because I like seriousness. She had gravitas. And so to have her say ditto, to have her support me, and ever since I joined the council, ever since I sat next to her, she said, she voted wrong again, but she kept supporting me. And you know, I'm a big fan of Tom Smyzik's, but I didn't get his support necessarily that first time when I ran, but I did have Patty's, you know, I did have a number of people. Phil supported me over the years, so, you know, that's meant a lot to me, but I don't know that I would have gotten over the hump in terms of being able to win without Patty, so I was very fortunate to sit next to her and to be able to turn her microphone off. Now, you all know this is true about him. No member of the city council, and maybe Mike Wywoody's a close second, but no member of the city council was more focused on data, and not just data, but accurately crunching it. Now, I haven't seen Mike do this. I have seen Phil do this. I have seen staff presentations get put together, and either Phil, out in the open, because they didn't listen to it privately, or in private, has said, "You got that wrong." And in spite of being Japanese, I'm a terrible math student, and I'm not that great with data. So in general, if you lay a graph in front of me, I'm going to believe you, unless you say 2 plus 2 equals 8. I'm not going to be with you. But, you know, in general, you can stump me with lies, damn lies, and statistics. You can't stump Phil. And again, he'll bring up, well, you're using the average, what about the mean? He'll get you 28 ways from Sunday. So I've always appreciated that about Phil. And I say that not as a small geeky thing. That's also a reminder to be good in governance. You can't always trust what's put in front of you. When city councils lose their support from the public, when you get voted out of office, it's oftentimes because you're being accused of being a rubber stamp, that you're not thinking for yourself. And so I've always appreciated that about Phil. That he goes the extra mile, and if you give him 100 pages to read, he reads those 100 and maybe 100 or something else. So, now the second part, Forever an Altruist, he's here tonight. He's volunteered with CHA, he's been on the Transportation Commission, he's been one of the directors down in the Caves. There's no group that Phil says no to, whether it's tennis, you name it. And so I think it's pretty easy, and I'm planning to do this myself, when you leave the council, to leave and just be like, you know what? I've done my time, but that's just not Phil's mantra. So, you know, I'm really honored to see you here tonight, and I've been honored to see you time after time, CTID, you name it. Phil steps forward and he serves on it. So, let's give Phil a round. Now, if you're sharp. figure out that there were two people I've served with that I didn't enjoy serving with as much as the rest. But tonight is not about pointing out those things. Tonight is about pointing out what contributions these people have all made. Because one of the things at the very end I'm going to tell you is, do mayors have legacies? And the answer is no, they don't. Mayors seldom are the ones that drive a decision. Mayors are seldom the ones that make a decision that everyone else has to follow. And Phil pointed it out. Really, mayors are only successful if two or more other people follow you into battle or agree with your decision. Mayors are lucky because we get all the credit, even though we don't do the implementing. The city managers do that. And so, anyway, back to Frank. So it was difficult to serve with Frank. And it was difficult because he seldom agreed with the rest of us. And it was difficult because he did not feel like the city council was doing a very good job. And he ran for council on that platform. If they're not doing a good job, I'll do a better job and I'll be a watchdog. So the first word I picked for him is fierce. And I mean it in good and bad ways. It is certainly good because he was passionate. He was always confident in his positions. And he just would not back down. Even if you explain to him, 2 + 2 does not equal 8. So, you know, obviously there were times where the people who served with Frank were, you know, hitting their head against the wall because you couldn't get anywhere with him when his heart was, you know, full of conviction that you're just dead wrong. But the second thing I want to point out, and I think most of you have noticed this about Frank, is he was fiercely loyal to his friends. Even if you don't like Frank, you have to like him for how he treated his mother, for one. Yeah. He was always mitten washing out for her. There were people like Mary Heron that he adored, Mike Napolitano. There were people out there that he really did, the Thieberges. He really went to bat for. His very first council meeting, he insisted that Tom Smyzik issue some kind of proclamation or key to the city to the Thieberges. Just. That's kind of a silly thing to do on your first day on the job, right? But don't tell, you know, you can tell Frank he's being silly and he will just punch you in the face and move on. And I have to say, in hindsight, I do respect the hell out of that. You know, who doesn't want a loyal friend? Who doesn't want someone that will fight for you even if it appears embarrassing to others? Now, I hate this part, but he was totally anti-tunnel. He always ran on it. He always bashed the rest of us who were pro-tunnel. And I hate this, but we all know the tunnel got smoked in 2010 at the ballot box 2-1. Maybe that's right, maybe that's wrong. What I do know is when you lose. And Frank was out in front of that. And there are other people that tried to take credit for that mantra, but again, Frank was against the tunnel before other people were willing to really brag about that. And frankly, he was vindicated to some extent in 2010 when the tunnel failed 67% to, you know, 33 or whatever the vote was. After that vote, the city council had a town hall meeting on traffic. And one of the things that I pointed out is all the years that Frank railed against the tunnel, he said that we should be synchronizing the lights on Orange Avenue the way they had done in La Jolla. You know, I thought at that point, he was right. You know, I don't know why we can't do it, but you know, that we can have a talk just on Caltrans for another day. I think it's important, even if you don't agree with someone, to call a spade, and if they're right, they're right. And whether I agree with them or not, the public said, Frank, you're right on the tunnel, and they killed it. So the next council that came into office, so the new member will be Kiri Nowney. I don't know if Phil will know this, but the rest of you may not. This picture is taken in like the community room of the Coronado Police Department. So in 2004, you know, the new city council chambers opens in 2005, so it's under construction. And so for about maybe a year or two, I got to use the old city council chambers, which were a recycled World War II waves and wax building, if I'm not mistaken. And it was no crown jewel, that last city hall. But you know, I liked it, you know, it was what it was. But we got kicked out of that whole area when they demolished it. And so we had council meetings for a year or two in the community room, and the two other rooms, the Emergency Operations Center and the community room of the police station. And you can tell by this beautiful furniture here. That beautiful backdrop. So, the new person on the scene in that election was Kiri Nowney, who I told you, we both ran for the city council unsuccessfully in 2000. But we both were fortunate. A lot of people, Patty and Phil won in 2000, Kiri and I eventually won. someone else in that group that I think did well. But in any event, a lot of people were able to get a second chance out of that group. Something that's interesting about Carrie Downey, and obviously I mentioned that she's an attorney. I'm sure you've all heard the joke, what do you call 100 attorneys at the bottom of the ocean? A good start. And that's sort of, I'm not saying that's right, but those jokes are out there. People don't lose a lot of sleep when you make an attorney joke. So, something that's worth noting about Carrie is obviously attorneys exist and they're well paid because there are times that you need them. And the other joke I'll tell you about attorneys is if you have a really complicated problem and you ask 5 attorneys for advice, you get 5 different solutions. Now, if you're gonna see a doctor, you know, if you have a heart problem, you don't wanna get 5 different, well, your heart's gonna blow up, well, it's a ventricle, it's, you know what? Well, how are you gonna treat me if 5 of you tell me? And that's the problem with lawyers. You really have to trust the person that you go with. And so when I say she's there when you need her most, a smart city council does not listen to any other attorney other than the one that you pay for, the city attorney, and that's not Carrie, she's a council member. So listen to what I'm saying. In general, you are unwise if you have an elected attorney on your city council and you let them bully you, if you let them keep saying, well, you know, it's been my experience as a lawyer. You're about to get in some trouble because that person's not the city attorney. And one of the things that's valuable about Carrie is that there are, first of all, a lot of times you're dealing with legal issues, and she knows how to share her opinion and her experience without being overburdening, or without overburdening you. She knows how to do it in a way without ever contradicting your city attorney. Even when she doesn't agree with it, she still backs off and lets the city attorney win. You just watch her roll her eyes a couple times. You know, she's being graceful about it. Here's the secret I want you to know. There are times when you have to go in a meeting without your attorney. And that's a terrible place to be in when you know what you're dealing with is complicated and strategic, and that's when she's your secret weapon. There have been some legal troubles between the city of Coronado and Imperial Beach, small, but they're there, and once in a while I've had to meet with their mayor, and it's been pretty handy. Once in a while I'll say, well, I'm gonna bring Casper Daddy with me. And I know that I have a little legal advice there. And again, 5 different lawyers, 5 different pieces of advice. She gives me the right advice in the times when you need it. Now, she's more than an attorney. She is like that with everything she does. When I was up for re-election in 2012, she had concluded, Casey, you are not campaigning hard enough. I'm just gonna step in and help you out. That's the type of person she is. She started printing, like this literature needs to be printed. She took over in a way that I needed. I was, I guess, not interested in that aspect of it. And that's her in a nutshell. She did that for the concerts in the park. They needed a little bit more help, a little bit more of an overhaul, engaged. Over and over, she's been like that. And you know, I was hoping she'd be my successor. She won't be, but that doesn't diminish what she's done in 10 years now on the council, what she'll do in the next 2. And I bet the next mayor is gonna be glad that Carrie's on the council too. So we were getting a little long in the tooth in the 2004 one, so we needed to bring in a bright young face. One Alan Overham. In all seriousness, those of you who know Alan know he had already served a term on the city council, and in fact, the seat that Phil was elected to was the one that Al vacated. He chose not to run for re-election because his grandkids were getting to be a certain age, and you know, and what's cool is he timed things right, and that in 2006, you know, he looked at his family where it was at, and he wanted to still help his community out. It wasn't going to harm him at home, so he ran for the council again, and he won. Now, I picked the first term deliberately because Kelly Purvis told me a story that when Mona Wilson, a former council member, was asked about Al, the first thing she said is, he's a gentleman. I don't always agree with him, but he always behaves properly, treats me right, he doesn't belittle people. And I think it's important to note that, because the second observation I have, if you aren't sharp, you're gonna think it's a dig at him, and it's not. You're not a very good city council if you always vote 5-0. You're not a very good city council if you have groupthink. And so Al's biggest contribution as a council member in terms of decision making is he was typically pretty skeptical of what we were doing. Not skeptical in a mean way, not skeptical he didn't trust your character. He just was kind of Dr. No at times. And it took a while to work, you know, to convince Al that something was a good idea. Something that I've observed about Al is when Al realized, well, it looks like four of you think this is a good idea, he'd often join you and vote with you. So again, he wasn't trying to be, you know, an obstructionist. He wasn't trying to be a jerk. He wasn't saying no for the sake of saying no. He just was a little bit more critical or a little bit needed more pushing or convincing. But I loved that, and the third point, he was a team player. Once the decision was made, you didn't hear him snicker, he wasn't posturing for the next election. So you could say, Tanaka said yes, I said no. Guess I was right. And a lot of people do that. You know, it's hard when you watch people vote, or when you see it's a 3-2 vote or a 4-1 vote. You can't help but wonder, you know, was there an ulterior motive there? Is this your chance to say I'm dissenting now to say I told you so later? Al Ober never said I told you so. He never brought up if he voted against you on something. And one of the things that's important about the city council is you send each of us off to represent the whole group over the bridge. And even if Al voted against something, he was not going to chop out your legs at Sandag or somewhere else. You wouldn't have known that he voted against that particular measure when you sent it out in the community. Now, with everyone else, I picked kind of a stock photo of, you know, this is how great this person looks. Something I want you to notice, I picked two pictures and not one. And these two pictures tell you, this guy is a team player. So Lambs did a 24 or 48 or 72 hour straight set of plays. And at one point they were doing a mixtape, I believe. And there's this segment from the 80s with Ghostbusters. And they thought, wouldn't it be cute to have a cameo from the city council? And I thought it was cute. If you think of the type of person that wants to do a cameo as a Ghostbuster, do you usually think of, you know, 70-something Al Ober? Right? Look at him. There's no frown. There's no reticence on his part. He wants to be a Ghostbuster, just like everyone else. Now, I hope you didn't miss how cool Richard looks there. That's what you'd expect from a Ghostbuster. But this guy wanted to be a Ghostbuster. Now, this other picture, it's not like a ward or something. This picture is the Al Ober you probably have seen yourself. I think one of the hallmarks of a great council member is that you attend civic functions, you attend city events. Now, it's not an accident that Mike Wywoody and Phil Monroe are here. That's the type of council member they are. They don't come up with an excuse why they can't be at the CHA event. They come up with a reason to say yes. Now, I won't say that Al has done it more than these two. I will simply say I don't know anyone who says yes more often. Again, he wants to be there. He likes that function. He doesn't let you down. Again, you need a Ghostbuster? Check. You need to swear in Lou Smith as a port commissioner? Check. He was always there. And that's, again, the mix of people you have. Some people have full-time jobs. Some are retired. Al understood. I'm retired. I can make a 10 a.m. event. I can make a 6 p.m. event. And again, he was happy to do so. So he was maybe even the ultimate team player. All right. For me, this is an exciting one because this is the year I become mayor. Something to notice, there are only four of us. And this was one of the fun councils to be on, in part because we had to overwork ourselves a little bit. I was already on the council, and so when I was fortunate enough to be sworn in as mayor, that meant my council seat went empty. And we had to decide, are we going to appoint someone? Are we going to call for an election? How are we going to handle this? And our decision ultimately was to leave the seat vacant. We weren't going to appoint someone. We were going to make sure that an election filled the seat. And the reason we did that, it's been my observation that there are a lot of people who would like to be on the city council if no campaigning is involved. True story, I have no grudge against that. But I will say, I don't think that's fair to the public. The whole point of the campaign is the public deserves a chance to get to know you. So I would just tell you this, there are a lot of people out there who will say this, I knew I'd be a great council member. I don't need an election to tell me that. You don't need an election to tell me that. And they'll pull Phil aside or Mike aside and they'll say, just want to put this out there, Mike. You know, you want to appoint me to city council? Yeah, I'm good with that. We got a lot of this. I have no problem with that. I'm just going to tell you, it's not what we did. The we were pretty adamant. If you want to be, you know, that fifth member, you're going to have to, you know, win the election to do it. So the four of us had to do a lot. But one of the I told you what I'm here tonight is to tell you I enjoyed the relationships. And so Mike was brand new at this point, so we got to know Mike really well. Gary was already one of our veterans, and we had the team player here, the Ghostbuster. And like I told you, in when you're playing shorthanded, who's pretty invaluable? This guy. Because again, he didn't have 7 a.m. classes that he'd be missing. He didn't have clients and money that she'd be losing. This guy is like this guy. That guy had he was pretty available at all times. And you need that as a council. If Carrie and I can't be somewhere, then it's incumbent on Al and Mike to step in. And again, if the mayor can't be there, sometimes that's a problem. So you need to make sure that the people who step in have the same gravitas that they did. So I choose my words carefully, and the very first word I chose was engineer. And I'm not an engineer, and I have to say it took me, I had to serve with a couple to get them. And one of the things Mike told me once is he said, you know, when engineers get called to jury duty, we usually get rejected.
Yeah.
And he said the reason why is that lawyers, when they're planning out their strategy and doing voir dire, and they want it, you know, they don't want someone that can turn the rest of the jury. And that's pretty profound. Again, they're logical. You know, when an engineer puts an argument forward, they're not full of bluster, they're not being a big bear with their claws out. Again, they're going through things one at a time. And you could lose a case. And also, Mike doesn't have to convince all 11, he just needs to convince one or two. And you got a hung jury, and that's a bad time. So the compliment that I want to pay Mike, and he's heard me say it before, of all the council members I'm going to tell you about, the one who's changed my mind the most has been Mike Wywoody. And he didn't do it by yelling at me, he didn't do it by sobbing at me or laughing at me. You know, he didn't use emotional appeals. He did it with cold logic. And there have been a few times, you know, for instance, we didn't agree on whether or not there should be a light at 4th and Alameda. And so it's one of the few times I didn't agree with him. And there are times where I'm like, I might be wrong. It's not comfortable when you're on the other side of the mic, because again, he's so coldly logical. You're wondering, am I the guy saying 2 + 2 = 8? I hope not, but I voted anyway. But again, there were a number of times, and I will tell you a little anecdote, and I don't know if Mike will find this funny. There is only one time where I felt that Mike used an emotional argument, and he won me over with it, and it was with bikes. You know, again, the rest of us were dawdling and hemming and hawing, and part of my French was getting pissed off. We weren't sticking to the facts, we weren't talking about the policy, and he kind of, in a Mike Wywoody-like way, kind of laid down the law to us, and I got it. And I decided, you know what, if I have to decide what side I'm on Mike's side on that. And we took grief for it. And every time we took grief, it's because we didn't do it Mike's way. We kept hemming and hawing. Maybe we made the right decisions, maybe we didn't. But the one person who didn't vacillate in that whole process, and the one person who could talk to you right now about where he stands, what he thinks the city ought to do when it comes to bikes, is Mike Wywoody. So I hate to bring up, you won me with an emotional argument just once. So the person who won the seat that I left behind, I told you there were two council members, I can't lie, there were two that were tougher to work with. So 2010, she actually won in 2009, I believe. But the new person who was filling the seat that I left behind was Barbara Denny. You don't have to like the people you work with, but you have to respect them. And the conclusion I've reached about Barbara Denny, and I think it's a valuable one, is that in any election, in Coronado or anywhere, I tell people, no matter what, wherever you're at, like if you're on the side that's gonna prevail, there's 20 or 30% that think you're an idiot. There's no way around it. Like everything I've ever done, when I've watched the election results, I've wondered, who the heck cast that vote? Like, what's the logic there? And so something I think is really important to understand about Coronado is there's a group of 1,000 to 3,000 people that no matter what thinks Casey Tanaka's a moron, Phil Monroe's a moron, Mike Wywoody's a moron, you're corrupt, you're dumb, that's just life, right? That's the group that's going to be the most distrustful of government. Every time something happens, they're going to see they did it again. And that was Barbara's service to this community. That group felt listened to. That group knew there was one person that wasn't going to vote with Phil or Casey or Mike. She often didn't. And again, I don't want to like blow sunshine here. It was unpleasant to serve with her many times. One of the tough parts about those years in the city council, and I've told people this a few times informally, it was an impossible time to be creative. You know, if you want to spitball an idea, I was always worried about how is she going to throw that in my face and try to like paint me as an idiot. And sometimes the safest thing to do is don't pitch an idea that might cause you to look like an idiot. So it was not easy by any means, but I do think it was a meaningful time in the city's history because sometimes, frankly, you need someone that doesn't agree with everyone else. And there were times where we were probably sharper because of it, because we were always on our feet and on our toes. So she did do Coronado, I think, an important service in that way. So we've talked about four of these guys. We haven't talked about someone who's about to become a mayor. I don't know if he'd appreciate this, but this is my take anyway. He joined the city council only 4 years ago. So I've been thinking about this. Ask yourself, what do you know about Richard Bailey 5 years ago? Probably nothing, right? And this isn't, I'm not knocking him. So if you recall this election, you probably heard of Richard Bailey at some point during that campaign, but I honestly didn't hear too many people saying, I'm voting for him. And I didn't hear a lot of people saying this, I bet he'll win. But I do remember a few people said, hey, this guy walked by my door. And they said either he's smart, a lot of them said he's handsome. They said something, right? You know, and something resonated when he stopped by their door. And anyone who's been involved in Coronado politics for any amount of time could tell you that someone who's willing to walk every door in Coronado or every door in whatever race they're in, they're playing with a type of fire that can make or break you. It can make you if you are charismatic. It can make you if people like you, if you are a good listener. And it can kill you if you're a jerk. I can think of a couple people that walked door to door in Coronado and probably lost for it. Because never got to see firsthand, you're not. I don't like you. But it's the truth, right? Just think about people walking, did it work? So let's give Richard Bailey credit for something. He had lived in Coronado for 3 years in this election of 2014. Most of the people had been around and, you know, could say things like, I have cookie makers older than you, that sort of comment. I've heard that said about one of my former principals. They didn't give Richard much of a chance. I didn't give Richard much of a chance. And like I said, in little, small groups, there were people saying, oh, this Richard Bailey guy's gonna win. And he did win. And he won because he walked door to door. He won because he connects with people. And I say he's a little engine that could because no major newspaper predicted Harry Truman was gonna win in 1948 because there were three Democrats on the ballot and only one Republican. And there was this phrase that came out where people said, I know Dewey's gonna win, but I don't know anyone who voted for him. And you have to give him credit. Richard was probably one of the few people in Coronado in 2014 who was like, no, you know what, I can win. I'm gonna prove it. I'm sorry?
2012. Yeah.
Sorry, thank you. I'm skipping ahead of the Bill Sankey here. Engineer.
I was running, I mean, I should know.
I'm glad you said that because after we had a forum at the Chamber of Commerce and they had all of us together, so that there were two candidates for mayor, Barbara and I think there were four or five of you running,
five,
and Richard was one of the five, and he didn't know me, or I didn't know him, and after that forum, and again, some of the exchanges between Barbara and I obviously were pretty testy, we didn't really care for each other, after one of the forums, Richard pulled me aside. So again, I've been in like a few elections at this point. I've lived in Coronado since 1983, but he pulled me aside and he literally said, hey, you need to pick it up a little bit, buddy. And he literally says, like, I'm not gonna tell this to everyone else, but I don't wanna see you lose, man. And yeah, I said, I didn't wanna hear that, to be honest, but you gotta tip your cap to the guy. He didn't mind telling the sitting mayor running for re-election, no. Now, think about not how I'm talking about Richard. I'm talking about him like this is a guy who's been around for a decade or two. That was 4 years ago. Yeah. And already in 4 years, and he didn't have the city mayor supporting him, he didn't have a single person on the city council supporting him, he won anyway. Now, he wasn't a long shot when he ran for mayor and won. But again, there were things, and I had the same problem. Tom Smizek didn't support me when I ran for mayor, and I got over it. And he has that same satisfaction. Again, the establishment, to some extent, they didn't support him. And he didn't need us. Again, he was driven and determined. He won, and he gets a smile back. The engineer was right. In 2014, it is a different group. And the new guy in this group, so we've talked about these four, but Bill Sankey. So I don't know if you've observed this about Richard, but I have. I think one of the areas where Bill has been distinguishing himself and where you know where he's going to go in terms of a vote has been on issues having to do with historic preservation, issues again, you know, fighting development and density. I've noticed that there have been splits on the city council, and the two people who have voted this most ardently for historic preservation are Mike Wywoody and Bill Sankey. And I don't know what the future is going to hold, and that obviously it pains me a little to say that because I'm a history teacher. I don't hate historic preservation. I'm not thinking to myself, hey, what house can we tear down? But you know, there's a balance to how you look at things, there's a balance to how you vote, and there's a balance to how you deny someone the ability to control their property. And Richard and Carrie have been the most strident about property rights and the property rights of the individual who owns the property. Susan Keith would be probably the first person to tell you, well, the community has property rights. And so when you vote down the right of one individual property owner to do what they want to do, that's the counter argument. For better or worse, I tell you I'm a moderate. You know, I don't want to see things go down, but I feel like if there are rules, you have to play by them. And I've made a point of not trying to bend the rules to accomplish the goal that I want. I don't think I've been perfect at it. I won't tell you which ones I feel like maybe I got wrong, but there were times where I voted where you couldn't get a demolition permit. There are times that I voted that you could. But Bill's been pretty consistent. Even on little things, when someone turns one lot into two because it's zoned for R3, it's zoned for a little extra condominium stuff, he's a former planning commissioner. And instead of just automatically saying, well, you know, that's what the rules say, and that's what we all say, he gets a little feisty about it. He'll tell you, I'm going to vote for this, but darn it, I really hate that I'm voting for it. And he'll spend some time on it. So I think when I say an eye to the future, I think that's one area where he connects to. The other area where he's been active, he went to Amsterdam recently. That was some high up Amsterdam guy to talk about climate change and how they're dealing with it and their locks and stuff. Now, if you ask him, he'll tell you he's a Republican. And usually, you don't put Republicans on that side of the issue. But again, I don't like to call out political parties, but I think he has an eye on the future that way. And so I think Coronado is in good hands with Bill Sankey on the city council. And I think it's good to have some people who vote yes and who vote no. And you know, when you need a Mike Wywoody or a Phil Monroe, an engineer to convince you, that's what you're doing. You know, who's going to win this argument? And I think it's good for our historic homes, and I guess for our environment, that Bill Sankey is on this council. So one of the sad things about tonight is there's no city council picture with me to put up right now. In 2016, I'm going to be gone. But one of the ones that I found that I think kind of captures where we're at, I mean, this is the future. These are the new leaders for our city. And obviously Richard won, but we're lucky to still have Carrie on the council. Whitney and Mike won. These three didn't win, but you know, again, Carrie and I lost the first time. We won later. You know, maybe one of those names will emerge. Someone I would say to watch would be Mark Hines. He keeps showing up to council meetings in a coat and tie. That sounds like someone who's serious. Now, I haven't served with Whitney, but I certainly know him. And again, I say this as a positive. Sometimes the best type of council member to elect is someone who grew up here, went to school here, graduated from here, came back to here. Bill Sankey did that. But you know, this guy's a little younger than Bill. So I can't call Bill a kid. I can't call Whitney Benzine a kid. But something that I said at a few of his events, because I did support him, is that I said I think he's been aiming his whole life towards this. And I think he chose the right time to run for the city council. He didn't run 2 years ago. He didn't run at other points. He's had some disappointments. He applied for our planning commission and he didn't get a spot on it. And part of the reason he didn't get a spot is he didn't at that time understand that Coronado does things in a way that the city of San Diego doesn't. In San Diego, if someone likes you, you're the only one they vote for. And in Coronado, if you've ever watched Bill or Mike or I vote, a lot of times if four people apply to the planning commission, sometimes you vote for all four. Sometimes it's because you're a wimp. But a lot of times when you vote for four people, what you're saying is, I believe all four of you are qualified. There have been a very rare number of times where I only voted for one person. Now, I didn't have this chance. We have a former court commissioner here, Admiral Spain, and I had a chance to vote for him, but he'd already been selected by the Tuckspizic Council. So he was going to get reappointed and selected. The next court commissioner after Admiral Spain was Lou Smith. And in that field of candidates, I only voted for Lou, and I only voted for him because I felt he was the one that was going to, on day one, move forward. And I didn't want anyone to get rolled by the San Diego council members, and he had already worked with a few of them on the Shark Court and so on. I don't know if I made the right decision or not. We have another admiral here who applied for that job who would have done just as good a job, I bet now, as Lou Smith. But nonetheless, I only voted for one person. I didn't want to give my support to anyone else. Whitney didn't get on the planning commission because I didn't vote for just one person. I voted for everyone. There was one person on the council that didn't vote for him, and it was Barbara Day. And so the person who did get appointed was voted on by all five, including Barbara. And so she won and he lost. He didn't get that. I remember he called me and said, what? I had to explain to him. Well, that's how this council does things. But why do I tell you that? He's paid his dues. He didn't give up. He didn't throw a tantrum. He didn't say, oh, Corrado's unfair. He just kept working, doing other things. And again, who was the leading vote getter for the city council race? Whitney Benzinger was. Now, I'll tell you something most of us probably already know. I don't know that anyone in here really knows Mike Donovan that well. And that's a good thing. He's his own man, and I think he won a seat on the city council because people trust him. And I think people don't expect him to get pulled one way or the other. I've heard our current city council, and Mike and I have talked about this a few times, I think we get frustrated when people accuse us of loving tourists more than our own residents. Like, it's not true. Disagree with us whatever reason you want, but don't assume that we like go to bed every night saying, how can we advantage tourists? But some of the things that we have supported have angered old-time Coronado residents. And I didn't support Mike because one of the things he said is he said for the last 15 years the council's been making some bad decisions. I've been on it for 14. Don't agree, right? But here's what I'll give him credit for. He ran on all of the types of things that a Patty Schmidt ran on and won. You know, one of the ideas that Tom Spicek ran on was residents first. That got resurrected. And again, some of the people who are proud that they've supported Patty Schmidt over the years supported Mike Donovan. Patty used to have a 4th of July party. And I remember a couple of those 4th of Julys, one of the people I would chat with, because I've taught his daughter and his son, Mike Donovan. So I say it with the highest regard that if you paid attention to what Mike Donovan said when he ran for council and now he's won a seat, it would not surprise me if he picked up maybe a little bit where Patty Schmidt left off. We're almost done. I want to take questions, but I wouldn't be a good member of a city council if I didn't praise the two city managers. Who I was extremely fortunate to have a chance to work with. I mentioned at our last council meeting that I teach 12th graders government and we're on local government right now. And one of the things I explained to them, mayors don't run anything. Mayors are simply the chairman of the board of the council. We hire someone to run the city. We hire, and I tell them to my bemusement, the mayor makes $8,000 a year. This guy makes something like $250 a year. And he earns every penny because he's the one that's on call, he's the one that directs staff, he's the one that picked the police chief and the fire chief and so on, not the city council. We don't even really approve those appointments. That's how much power, that's how much authority is given to a city manager. And again, I think we can all attest that have served on the city council that we've had two of the greatest serving our city. Just a quick word about Mark. He is a workaholic. As soon as he retired from Coronado, he went back as like an interim city manager for Del Mar. He doesn't know how to retire. But something I do want to point out is it's a 24-hour job. When there is a fire or a disaster, the mayor or Mike or Phil is not the first phone call, he is. And he's one of the people that needs to be on the scene because he outranks the police chief, he outranks the fire chief, and he's the one that acts with the authority of the city council. And we've had some weird incidents. Again, we've had an off-duty police officer shoot a San Diego Charger. I don't know if you know this, but maybe 15 years ago, there was some guy trying to steal a bike on one of the lots near North Island. And like two people got shot and the third tried to crawl all the way to the bridge. That happened at like 3 a.m. There's weird stuff that happens in Coronado. They don't necessarily wake us, but they do wake the city manager. And I really believe that he left us in 2009 because he was probably tired of the 24-hour nature of his job. I don't know if you know Blair King, but he is great. And one of the things that's great about him is he doesn't lose his temper. He doesn't lose his calm. I've seen it happen just once or twice. It's because of me. But generally, he doesn't. And when you talk about someone who then has, 10 department heads, you couldn't have a finer person in terms of a boss to work for. A boss that values you, who doesn't yell at you, who doesn't yell and run in a circle and think that's leadership and so on. Blair is eternally calm. And he doesn't have an ego. That's why I mentioned humble. And when I say supremely confident, try to stump him. Ask him about sewers. Ask him about AQ. Ask him about whatever you want. And he will probably tell you, as humbly as he could, well, when I was at the city of Lodi. Or when I was the city manager at Half Moon Bend. Or, it was weird in 1991 in Imperial Beach. He's seen it all. And he's not a jerk about it. He's a real fountain of knowledge. And when Mark left, I thought he was going to be impossible to replace, and he wasn't, fortunately. And Blair's very different from Mark. They're both great in different ways, but my biggest concern is I knew we had an all-star staff. I knew all of our departments had great people leading it, and I just wanted to make sure that we hired someone that would make the most of that and not scare him. Like, the worst thing you have is a bad boss, right? And so we hired a good boss. This jerk called me the Hawaiian shirt prince, Hawaiian shirt wearing prince of the night. But my first conclusion about what have I learned in 14 years, mayors don't really have legacies. If you do things right, you simply didn't break the place. And so Tuesday night I was waiting for a pizza after a council meeting and someone came up to me and said literally that, thanks for not screwing up the place. That's true, right? And if you're Bob Filner, you screw up the place, you get fired, and that's all people remember is that you're a heinous person. So don't screw up the place. What continues to be as strong as Phil left it, as Tom left it, as Patty left it, the city's finances are great. And I would say maybe I've conceded, but I think the levels of service that people expect from the city are there. If there's something the city isn't doing, and you know that and you're mad about it, the money is there to fix it later. You just need to convince Whitney or Mike or Carrie or Richard or Bill. Get three of them to agree with you and increase the number of police officers or firefighters or pick up trash more often. Admiral Spain told me we're not picking up trash on the beach enough. Probably right. And again, we're not perfect. You just need to get one of us to agree and convince two others. But again, if you can do that, the money is there to do it. Some people know that a Facebook post I had that had like 600 likes was I was going to work one day. This was only 2 months ago. And some guy was walking his dog, and I'm a politician, so I say hi to people. This guy's walking his dog, and I said, good morning. And the guy said, don't hi me. Fix Third Street. if you read the post, I said, okay. I look forward to the mayor of the council that can fix our traffic, but all we have been able to do is to try to manage what exists the best we can. And overdevelopment is a tough one to figure out, because in this state, if you tried to lower density in one area, you have to raise it somewhere else. Yeah. In this state, if you have a map that sits there, you can't just spot zone it and change it around. And it doesn't make anyone happy to tell them that. And that's why I mentioned, you know, sometimes Bill is just like, what are we doing? And that's the, he's, you know, that's the reality we face. It's very difficult for us to take votes and to take actions that really change the problems we see out there when you see, you know, four homes under construction on a various street. We're all trying, but I don't know that any of us are ever going to fix that. Something that I'm sad about and that I'm proud about, we lost redevelopment. We rebuilt all of our schools, all of our city buildings because of it, and then they took it away in 2012. But one of the things that from Tom Smyzik to Casey Tanaka that we did is we lent, the city lent money to redevelopment to build things now, knowing that there'd be money there later to pay back the city's loans. When they killed redevelopment in 2012, they explicitly said, loans cannot be repaid. Any of you have lived in California any amount of time, though they're not very smart in Sacramento. And they wrote this law. I'm gonna give you a couple of examples. They're not very smart in Sacramento because the law that they wrote to not allow loans to be repaid had a loophole. We do our homework in Coronado, we found a loophole, we re-entered the loans legally, and they're back on the books. And California is a jerk sometimes, so they just said, no, we won't do it, we won't get it. Well, we sued them, and we won. We offered the state, we just want the principal back, we don't want any interest. The state, like a credit card fiend, said, no, we don't want you to pay it all off up front, we want to pay you back over 20 years. So they won't allow the money to be repaid back quickly so that the school district can become a basic A district. They won't allow it. They are going to pay us $2.7 million a year every year until 2036. That means Coronado is going to pick up $62 million by the time 2036 rolls around. That's in addition to the $43 million we have in the bank. That's more money that'll come back. So we lost redevelopment, but we're going to get our money back. Lovable enigma. You love the Navy, you love the sailors, but as an organization, it is impossible to negotiate with them. What level? The local level, the mid-tier, Washington? At no level have we ever been able to get decisions, things in writing. And again, you know, city council is usually full of 60% naval veterans. So it's not that we don't respect the military and love the Navy, but they are really hard to deal with. And they're smart. And in the end, they usually protect their interests. And if their interests are not the same as yours, you're not going to win. They're an enigma. I've not figured them out, but I emphasize they're lovable. All right. And that is it. Questions. I don't know how much time we have left, but I'm still the mayor, so we can stay here. Yes, ma'am.
So how do you think that the resident sort of anti-tourism feeling is going to play out over the next couple of years as it relates to the city's budget?
Well, I'm glad you bring up the city's budget, because all of us in the council who have voted for things like the CTID keep pointing out that the hotel tax is our second biggest revenue source. And so when we do things to try to support different programs to keep the hotels full, that's the reason why we do it. I think we're just gonna have to wait and see. I think Mike Donovan ran at least partially against some of those programs. Whitney is new. We've seen Richard before, but we haven't seen him as mayor. And so I think that's one of the number one things to watch. I think to some extent, it's probably likely that they're gonna roll back on something. So the first thing I would watch is there's been some talk. There are two CPIDs because of state law, it had to be divided up. So that's one thing to watch in the next year, whether or not one of them gets eliminated. The way the CPID was set up, so this is something that takes 1% is added on top of the hotel tax. So 10% goes to the city, and there's kind of like this phantom 11%. That 1% can be controlled by a group that includes a representative from the CHA, the Chamber, Main Street, and then each of the big four hotels has a representative as well. That money, which amounts to maybe a little over $1 million a year, can be used to target things that will put people into the hotels, and can be used to target things that help our local Coronado small businesses. They were, so 0.5% goes to CTID1, 0.5% goes to the other. I would say, you know, watch this next council and see. Every year we set it up, it has to be reapproved every year. So every year there's an opportunity to kill it if it's not needed or if it's not popular. So I guess I would predict that they'll both make it, but I wouldn't bet money on that prediction.
Okay, what's going on with the sewage smell around the amphibious guys? Is that the Navy's fault?
Yeah.
No, that's not the Navy's fault. That's a city project. So when you do a project, so we were doing a wet well, I forget all the specifics, but you have to put out a bid, say what the project is, and you have to take the low bid or you have to reject all bids. So the group that won that bid, frankly, is underperforming. And so we were doing our best to make them perform. We're doing our best to get them the hell out of there and to get the project completed adequately. But we haven't had too many times where the bid process has failed us, but I'll tell you that's one time where if we had to do it over again, hopefully there would have probably been a different firm doing that work.
Thank you. Casey, I was wondering, as a parent and a resident, you talked about Sacramento, and I get frustrated, especially with that latest local control funding formula.
Yes.
And you're in the system also. And it just seems odd how the school seems to get punished by that. And yet at the same time, the city has a bunch of money. And I know they kind of stay separate, but what are your thoughts going forward? Like you just talked about the money being dribbled in over 10 years. Is there any way to help fix that? Or
no. Ultimately, the answer to your question, I think, is no. It's not really legal for the city to use its money to help the schools. So there's a law, it's called a gift of public funds. So the city can't say, you know, Casey, you've been such a great mayor, we're going to give you a gift of $100,000. Not legal to do that. There's no public purpose served by gifting money in a certain way. So if the city wants to help the school district, you have to be able to prove that there is some public service being provided with that money for the residents of Coronado. It's subjective, and so we have found some ways to pay for tutoring and crossing guards and even some counseling services and so on. That's in the past. Currently, one way the city helps the schools is that we pay them a certain amount of money every year, and in exchange they keep their facilities open now on weekends and at nights. So those people who like to jog around the football field, we've accomplished that by switching. So there are some ways where we can help the school district out, and that's, I think, to the tune of $340,000 a year to open all of their facilities up to the public. And that is about the most creative way that we can try to help the schools. They have to do it on their own. And even though the funding formula they have clearly disadvantages us against San Diego, we're just going to have to deal with it. Other questions? Up here.
Is it true that we have reached a point where 60% of our residential properties are second homes? Is that true?
I don't know. I can't verify that. I haven't seen that. I would guess that's not true, but I haven't seen any. Oh. Thank you.
Because the mayor of Coronado, Casey Tanaka, is not going to take this lying down.
But the public wire station, yeah.
Okay, never mind. Maybe he is going to take it lying down. I'm surprised. Look at this guy. He's the mayor. He's wearing a shirt, and he has what looks like the beginnings of a pretty sweet ponytail. You do not bow to this pressure, because we here at the Late Late Show, we stand with you, you Hawaiian shirt wearing prince of the night.
There are places all these places have the moments without.
I'll remember.